On Mystery Monday, we covered the suspicious story of Floating Eye Island in the country of Argentina. We spoke briefly about Argentina's involvement in World War II, or rather, their involvement in post-World War II activities. And today, we're going to take a deep dive into one of Argentina's most infamous citizens. But before we go any further, you know what to do. Please hit that subscribe button and give us a like. As always, a very, very, very special thank you to all of our producers and our patrons. If you would like to join our Patreon community, there is a link down in the description box below. Welcome to Esoteric Atlanta. My name is Bryce, and today we are going to be talking about the legendary Evita. Yes, before we get into the story of Eva Peron, aka Evita, I do want to acknowledge that I am back in my bedroom. The key to a healthy and happy relationship is compromise, and my boyfriend is using the main room today for some of his work, so I gladly am back here with you all to talk about this Argentinian actress turned politician. I also want to acknowledge that it is incredibly hot in Atlanta, Georgia right now. One of our nicknames is Hot Lana, and so I do have the fan on over my head. You might see my hair blowing, but it is way better than the air conditioning unit because that is super loud. So if my hair blowing bothers you, then I would suggest just listening to this episode and not watching. Besides some pictures I'm going to be showing you guys of Evita, there really is no need to watch me because I'm literally just telling you the story. For my sister and me, growing up in the 80s and the 90s, our mother was very adamant that we have experience in the arts. We both took dance lessons, we both learned how to play the piano, and we both were involved in community theater. My mother also took us into Atlanta to the Fox Theater anytime there was a national tour from New York. For my sister and me, we grew up listening to record after record of soundtracks from Broadway hits and West End smashes. So for me growing up, I always knew who Eva Peron was because in 1978, Tim Rice and Andrew Lloyd Webber created a magnificent musical based on the life of Eva Peron. According to Tim Rice himself, he was always interested in Eva Peron because when he was a child, he remembered seeing a stamp with her face on it. As a child who grew up in Great Britain, he had never seen a regular person on a stamp before because growing up in England, the Queen's face, the monarch's face, was the face on stamps and currency. After the success of Jesus Christ Superstar and Joseph and His Amazing Technicolor Coat, Tim Rice and Andrew Lloyd Webber got to working on their third hit. Now, something I did not know is that before the musical of Evita, not many people outside of the country of Argentina knew who Eva Peron was. In fact, in the play Evita, Che Guevara is the one who narrates her story. He narrates her story in a very judgmental way because, you see, Che was also a revolutionary from the country of Argentina. And although Che and Eva Peron's paths never crossed, having him narrate the story, he who was way more recognizable to the public, was a way to get people into the theater. Now I think it's safe to say that most people know who Eva Peron was. And I personally believe that the musical of Evita is what pushed Eva Peron from being famous to infamous. Eva Peron was originally played by Elaine Page in the 1978 release of Evita in the West End, but would go on to be played by Madonna in the 1996 movie adaptation of the play. This is very, very interesting to me. You see, before the Great Awakening, anybody could look at the story of Evita and see it's a typical Cinderella story. Here is a girl who was born illegitimately on the wrong side of the tracks in Argentina, who became an actress and then married a politician and would go on to become the First Lady of Argentina. But now that we know, the story that they give us isn't actually, most of the time, the accurate story, I have a lot of questions. Questions that I hope at the end of this deep dive, we can speculate on. And then hopefully in a future episode, dive a little deeper with our friend Janine from Tarot by Janine and Tom Numbers. But for now, how did a woman born illegitimately on the wrong side of the railroad tracks grow to become one of the most powerful women in her time? Maria Eva Duarte was born the last of five illegitimate children. The birth certificate that we have says that she was born on the 7th of May, 1919. However, this date conflicts with her baptism certificate because her baptism certificate was also for the 7th of May, 1919 for Maria Eva Abaguerin. Abaguerin was her mother's maiden name. Duarte was her father's surname. Now, Eva, or Evita, as her friends and families called her, was born extremely poor in the town of Los Toldos in Argentina. Although Evita and her four other siblings were extremely poor, her father, on the other hand, was not. You see, Juan Duarte was a very wealthy businessman, and he had a legal family in a different town. Apparently, this was quite common in this time in Argentina. It wasn't like these two families were kept secret from each other. When Eva was about a year old, her father went back to his legal family, leaving Evita, her siblings, and their mother destitute. And to make matters worse, a few years later, her father was killed in an accident. There's a famous story, which is covered in the play of Evita as well as the movie adaptation, where Evita's mother took her and her siblings to their father's funeral. Once they got to the funeral, the legal wife got into a bit of an altercation with Evita's mother, his mistress, causing quite an uproar at the funeral. Now, according to the history books, Evita, her siblings, and their mother did get to pay their respects to their deceased father. However, they had to leave immediately. In the play and in the movie, it's only little Evita that runs into the church and gets to see her father before being kicked out of the ceremony. Well, because Evita and her siblings were considered illegal or weren't considered natural children at the time because the mother, their mother, wasn't married to their father, they unfortunately were not included in any inheritance from their father. However, their father did leave a piece of paper claiming that the children were his, therefore could carry Duarte his last name. This goes back to Evita's birth certificate. It is believed by historians that Evita made a fake birth certificate on the same date as her baptism in order for her to then go and marry Juan Peron later on in the story. At this time, being an illegitimate child was highly stigmatized in Argentina. Maria, her siblings, and their mother all ended up living in a one-bedroom apartment together. Her mother did what she could, cooking meals for families, sewing, just doing basic household chores to get paid to try to keep her family afloat. Eventually, Evita's older brother was able to go out and get a job and send money back to the family, so they were able to buy a boarding house. This helped the family's financial situation immensely. Now, little Evita always had a love for the theatrics. She loved movies and the idea, the fairy tale idea of these amazing, amazing actresses all over the country of Argentina. So if you want to be a famous actress in Argentina, the place to go would have been, of course, Buenos Aires. At this point, Buenos Aires was the capital of Argentina, still is, and was also Argentina's version of Hollywood. Interestingly enough, in the 1930s, Buenos Aires was the third largest city in all of the Americas. It only came third to New York and Chicago. Evita knew that if she wanted to make a life for herself, she would have to get out of this small, poor town and make her way to the big city. And in 1934, at just 15 years old, Evita took her opportunity to run off. Now, the story of Evita, the Hollywood, the theater story of Evita, claims that she ran off with a famous Argentine tango singer named Agustin Magadali. Now, in the play and in the movie, it makes it seem like Evita and this tango singer had a bit of an inappropriate relationship, and she kind of weaseled her way into going back to Buenos Aires with him. And when they get to Buenos Aires, she learns that he has a family, and there's a huge song about what happens now as she's making her way through Buenos Aires. However, many people question this story. A lot of people believe that it was actually her mother that brought her to Buenos Aires to let her start auditioning for plays and radio shows. Now, again, I have my questions about the whole inception of this person. But again, we'll get that clarification later on with Janine and Tom. But needless to say, this 15-year-old girl with no education, who comes from a very stigmatized background and no money, is now wandering the streets of Argentina. Throughout her life, rumors followed her about her rise to success. Many of the people who didn't like her or were very dubious of her whispered about how she got the jobs that she got. Did she sleep her way to the top? Was she a product of the casting couch? Many people today believe that these were nothing but rumors started by her competitors or the people who were highly against her and her eventual husband, Juan Perón. But again, I'm not so sure. There's a lot we know about that we didn't know about a few years ago. So if she did sleep her way to the top, I wouldn't be surprised. Although, if she did sleep her way to the top, it was probably in more contrived ways than the ways that we typically think about people doing that to get ahead. Even though Buenos Aires was the third largest city in the Americas and also was called the Paris of South America at the time, there was huge unemployment. Poverty was everywhere. We were at the beginning of the Great Depression. The Great Depression affected the whole globe, and all the people that lived in rural Argentina were having to make their way into Buenos Aires to try to find work. It was definitely a dog-eat-dog situation and survival of the fittest. There were many stories of the young Eva Peron, Eva Duarte, at this time being extremely skinny and taking any free food she could. On March 28th of 1935, Evita's luck changed. She landed a stage job in the play La Señora de Perez. In 1936, she began touring with the National Theater Company and picked up many modeling gigs. She also started to perform in dramatic melodramas on the big screen and in radio, because if you can remember, radio was really popular at this time. Now, it is said that Eva Peron, or Eva Duarte at this point, was not the best actress in the world, but there was definitely something about her, some it factor, that allowed her to continue to land jobs. In 1942, she was hired by a soap company to do a daily ad on a radio program called Muy Bien. This would end up being her big break. Now, I kind of giggle at this, and I know the feminists watching are going to hate me for saying this, but you can't change history. It just is what it is. The title of soap opera comes from soap companies, because during the day in all over the world, when housewives would be at home doing their housewife duties, they would either listen to the soap operas on the radio or now on TV. And so these soap companies, through product placement and advertisement, would advertise their cleaning supplies to the women who, again, were the ones watching or listening to these soap operas from their house while their husbands were out working. So the fact that Eva Peron landed a gig, basically doing a daily commercial for a soap product on a radio soap opera, is very typical of this time period. And again, it is historically accurate as to why we call them soap operas today. Now, this was quite lucrative for Evita. It would be quite lucrative today as well. If you landed a gig where you were doing a daily ad spot on shows, you can best assured your financial problems were most likely over. She also went on to sign a 5-year contract with Radio Belgrano, where she played biographical roles like that of Queen Elizabeth I. And she might not have been that great of an actress, but she was a savvy businesswoman. She eventually worked her way to co-owning the radio program. At this point, Eva Duarte, soon to be Eva Peron, became the highest paid actress in Argentina. Not bad for an illegitimate child with no education. While Eva was hustling and bustling her way to the top of Buenos Aires' acting circle, the backdrop of Argentina was military and civil unrest. In 1943, there was a military coup. Now, I'm not going to go specifically into all the deep and finer details of all these coups that we see happening in Argentina at this time. In fact, I hope to go a little deeper into those coups when we do our follow-up with Janine and Tom. For today, I want to focus on Eva Peron's life and her role in what happened in Argentina. How did she go from being a radio actress to the First Lady of Argentina? After the military coup in 1943, Juan Perón became the Secretary of Labor under the new leadership. Juan Perón himself had also been born illegitimate. He was a good bit older than Evita. In fact, he was 24 years older than Evita. However, Juan Perón's life was not as much of a struggle as Evita's because his parents eventually did get married. But nonetheless, Juan worked his way up through the military and became a crucial part in all the goings on in Argentina politics at this time. On January 15th of 1944, a massive earthquake happened in the town of San Juan that killed 10,000 residents. Juan Perón, as the Secretary of Labor, established a fundraiser for the victims. Our celebrities and politicians basically do the same shit today. Anytime there's a natural disaster, which we now know they might not be so natural, the celebrities, politicians, the elite get together on TV and try to raise money for all of the victims. 10, 20 years ago, we might have applauded them for doing this. Oh, how kind it is for the elite group of people to have mercy on us have-nots down in the main world. But now we know there's manipulation there, and I'm pretty sure there was manipulation here as well. During this fundraiser for the victims of San Juan, Juan Perón invited all sorts of celebrities all over Argentina to basically beg for funds for a week, which ended in a huge gala in Buenos Aires where they all got to dress up and schmooze with each other, basically scoffing at the victims of this earthquake. I mean, how tacky is that? To have a gala after a fundraiser where you're trying to raise funds for people who have been devastated by an earthquake. It's just so f***ed up at this point to think about. But nonetheless, this is when Evita met Juan. It was basically love at first sight for both Juan and Evita. Evita was only 24 years old at this time, and Juan himself was 48. Now, I'm not too finickety about age differences in couples. My boyfriend is 10 years older than me, but 10 years is not that big of a gap as 24 years is. In fact, Juan could have been her father. Was this daddy issues for Evita playing out in her life, or was this something more sinister and perhaps pre-planned by the powers that be that have been in control of our world for a very long time? Evita basically became Juan's mistress. When she met Juan, she claimed to have no knowledge of politics, but being a savvy street girl like she was able to pick up on stuff as she overheard Juan discussing military tactics and moves with his colleagues. She claimed she would be serving them coffee, and then she would whisper her opinions to Juan, and eventually, she became Juan's student. He tutored her through politics and through his ideas of a better Argentina. In May of 1944, it was announced that all radio actors and producers and employees had to form a union. You would not be able to work in radio in Argentina if you did not become a part of this union. Once the union was created, Eva Duarte, soon to be Eva Peron, was nominated to be its president. This was a huge move in the game of chess for Juan Perón and his eventual dictatorship. Eva Duarte started a daily program called Toward a Better Future. And this daily program went over all of the accomplishments of Juan Perón. We see the establishment or the beginnings of the establishment of what is called Perónism, a political ideology that is still alive in Argentina today. The Peronism attracted what they called the descamisados. These were the shirtless ones. It was an ideal that really, really focused on the welfare of the working man. Coming out of the Great Depression and with World War II happening in the world, having a political figure say that he's going to take care of the working man was very appealing to the labor force of Argentina. And who better to be the mascot of this movement than Eva Duarte herself, a woman born into poverty that worked her way to the top. You see, she understood what the working class was going through because she was one of them. By 1945, other military groups started to get stronger in Argentina. And the then President Pedro Pablo Ramirez was very concerned about Perón's growing power and influence. On the 24th of February 1944, Ramirez signed his resignation paper. This resignation paper was drafted by Juan Perón himself. At that point, a man named Eldemiro Julian Farrell stepped in as the president of Argentina. Juan Perón was a close friend of him, and once again, Juan Perón became the Minister of Labor. Suffice it to say, Juan Perón at this point was now one of the most powerful men in Argentina. And with a beautiful actress, young actress girlfriend who was of the working class, his power was growing by the day. On the 9th of October of 1945, Juan was arrested by his enemies in government. They arrested him because they feared him. They feared his popularity. 6 days later, 350,000 people protested Juan Perón's arrest outside of the Casa Rosada. The Casa Rosada is basically the Pink Palace. In the United States of America, we have the White House. In Argentina, they got the Pink House. This is also the very famous building where Evita would go on to give her speech. And if you've seen the play Evita, or the movie Evita, or you're familiar with the music of Evita, this is where the infamous Don't Cry For Me Argentina comes from. It comes from the Casa Rosada. With over 250,000 people outside of the Casa Rosada protesting Juan Perón's arrest, the government was forced to release him. He was released at 11 p.m. at night. Later on, there would be a lot of folklore added to the story. People would say that Eva Peron herself went door to door knocking, begging for people to come out to stand in front of the Casa Rosada and to protest with her. But we know that probably wasn't true. I mean, hell, these people had already been brainwashed and manipulated by these radio programs. They didn't need her to go knocking door to door, and they just did what they had already been programmed to do. 1 week after Juan Perón was released from prison, he and Eva officially got married. They were first married in a civil ceremony on the 18th of October, 1945, and then later in December in a church ceremony. Still to this day, the 17th of October, the day before their wedding, is considered Perónism Day, or the birth of this official movement. Although we know its inception had started long before. Juan Perón then decides that he is going to actively run for president. And once again, he uses his wife's good look, beauty, charm, and her radio program to do his campaigning. Juan Perón wins in a landslide. And as he started to rule Argentina, he ruled with an iron fist. Technically, he is considered a president, but many people today call him a dictator. In 1947, Eva Peron goes on what is called her rainbow tour. She's going to tour all the big countries of Europe as the face of Argentina. She does this alone. She starts off in Spain. Now, as we spoke about on Monday, Spain had remained neutral during World War II in Europe because Spain had already gone through its own civil war. Spain would also be used as a stepping stone into Argentina for the Axis powers who were escaping justice during the Nuremberg trials. When Evita got to Spain, she was heavily loved and adored by the Spanish citizens. She didn't have that great of a reception in Italy, and then she went on to meet Charles de Gaulle in Paris, but canceled her trip to the UK because the then monarch, King George VI, Queen Elizabeth's dad, didn't want to see her. She claims that she canceled the trip to the UK because she was exhausted, but many people believe she canceled this trip because she felt snubbed by the monarch of England. When she got to Switzerland, things went south. In Switzerland, she had stones thrown at her car, one which hit her, she was okay though, and tomatoes thrown at her dress. This is interesting because many people believe that her rainbow tour was really just a way for her to go and to deposit money into Swiss bank accounts for her and her husband. Because as you see, my friends, it's about to get real. Once again, as World War II was ending in Europe, Peron, an ally to the Axis forces, was welcoming Nazis into his country and giving them new identities. As we mentioned on Monday, a month before the end of World War II, Argentina officially joined the war to fight against Germany. But as we mentioned on Monday, that was all a ruse. Because for Argentina, sending military troops into Europe was a way to help filter them into Argentina. And of course, to Antarctica, which, as we talked about Monday, Argentina has a portion, pretty large portion of Antarctica. After Switzerland, Eva Peron throws her hands in the air and says that's enough. After 2 months of touring around Europe, she's going to go back home to Argentina. Around this time, Eva Peron also was on the cover of Time magazine. She was the first South American First Lady to ever be on Time magazine's cover. Later on, there would be another cover piece with her and her husband, but the fact that she held a solo picture on Time magazine was a pretty good deal. However, this magazine was banned from Argentina for a few months because apparently they kind of let it slip that their first lady, Eva Peron, was born out of wedlock, and again, that was still stigmatized in the country of Argentina. Once Eva Peron became the First Lady of Argentina, she had a really hard time making friends. The high society ladies, her husband's colleagues' wives, did not accept her. They saw her as tacky and crass. She was definitely not one of them. When Eva Peron became the First Lady, there was a charity called the Sociedad de Beneficencia. This was basically the official government charity for the poor. It was run by 87 wealthy upper-class ladies. Their main focus was the orphans in Argentina, and they would make the orphans dress in like blue smocks and like shave their head. And during Christmas time, they would send the orphans out on the streets of Buenos Aires with cups to basically beg for money. This was supposed to be some sort of lesson in humility and in charity for the rich people. Like, the orphans were like learning humility and the rich people were learning to give. I don't know, it seems really screwed up to me, and Eva Peron thought so as well. In fact, Eva Peron was quoted as saying, "When the rich think about the poor, they have poor ideas." Now, it was customary for the First Lady to be the president of this governmental charity, but the society women refused to give Eva the position. I'm sure Eva Peron had grand ideas about what she could do with this charity, but being snubbed by these society women pushed Eva over the edge. This charity was basically funded by the government, and with Juan Peron in charge as the president or the dictator, she was able to cut off funding to this charity. This enabled Eva Peron to open up her own charity. And on the 8th of July of 1948, Eva Peron established the Eva Peron Foundation. When the Eva Peron Foundation was established, there was basically no social or government welfare in Argentina. Basically, there was no government assistance. There was no food stamps, nothing that we know of today when we think of social projects for the poor. This did not exist at that time. Again, the only charity the government really had was this charity with these elderly little ladies that were basically humiliating orphans. And so Eva sought to change this. Because she had grown up poor in Argentina, she was very, very well aware of all the hardships many of the Argentine lower class dealt with. Her foundation goals were to provide scholarships to poor children, build homes, hospitals, and schools. And on the outside, it appeared that Evita was so passionate about this foundation that she herself would go into the poor neighborhoods, handing out aid and parcels to those who needed it. This definitely gave the illusion to the people of Argentina that Evita, even though she was super wealthy and the most powerful woman in the country, was still one of them. By the end of the 1940s, Eva's foundation had 3 billion pesos worth of wealth. Now, what's interesting about her foundation is that it does appear that there was stuff done. The money was used to do some good. However, many speculate that what the public saw of this foundation was merely just an illusion, because it appeared that there were not many books kept on where the money was going. And people talk about how the Perones strong-armed businesses and people to donate a percentage of their income into this foundation. For example, there were stories that places like restaurants and movie cinemas would be shut down by the government if they didn't give a percentage of their income to her foundation. We also know that in 1950, the Congress of Argentina ruled that part of the lottery would have to go into her foundation. All we do know is that the Perones got richer and richer and richer. I can't help but think that Eva Peron's foundation reminds me a lot of another foundation in our modern times that was run by a First Lady of the United States that we now know was super nefarious. Because of the illusion of Evita being one of the people and doing all this stuff to help the people, Evita became kind of like the saint of Argentina. Now, Argentina is a very Catholic country, still is. But the people almost looked to Evita like she could do no wrong. This made Evita very divisive, though, because, again, the people, the working class, saw her as this savior, whereas other people in the country saw her as an absolute enemy of the state. On June the 9th of 1950, Eva Peron fainted in public. She was rushed to the hospital where she immediately had surgery. She told her husband, as well as the public, that it was nothing but an appendicitis, an appendectomy. But really, Eva Peron had been diagnosed with cervical cancer. In 1951, Juan Peron, her husband, nominated Evita to be his vice president. No more did he want her just to be the first lady. He wanted her to have an active role in the politics of Argentina. Evita would decline his nomination, saying that she wanted her place in history to be nothing but his supporter. That could all be true, that she only wanted to be his supporter, but underneath that, her health was declining. I'm not sure when Juan Peron found out that his wife actually had cancer, but somewhere around this time, her vaginal bleeding was becoming excessive, and she herself went in to have a hysterectomy to try to solve the problem. Unfortunately, though, it was too late. The cancer had spread. Eva Peron would go on to be the first woman in South America to undergo chemotherapy for her cancer. It has also recently been reported that people believe Eva Peron had a lobotomy to try to ease the pain and the anxiety. On her 33rd birthday, May 7th of 1952, or what we assume is her 33rd birthday, her husband gave her the title of Spiritual Leader of the Nation. About a month later, on June 4th of 1952, Eva Peron accompanied her husband in a parade to campaign for his re-election. By this point, she was so sick that she could not even stand up. They had to make plasters and stands to hold her up in the car so that she could see the people and so the people would not be aware of just how sick she was. She wasn't just sick, though. Eva Peron was dying. Around this time, Eva Peron only weighed about 80 pounds. They made sure that she always had heavy coats on to disguise the fact that her body was withering away. On the 26th of July, 1952, at 8:25 p.m., Eva Peron died. Immediately on the radio, an announcement was made. The press secretary's office at the presidency of the nation fulfills its very sad duty to inform the people of the republic that at 8:25 p.m., Mrs. Eva Peron, spiritual leader of the nation, has died. This put the country of Argentina into deep and painful mourning. After her death, all the flags were placed at half mast and all the official government businesses were forced to close for a few days. Then the government mandated that all the private businesses, small businesses, should also close for a few days so that the people could mourn. Millions and millions of people gathered all over the streets of Argentina, blocking any traffic from coming through. In fact, the stampede was so big of mourners that 8 people lost their lives and many, many, many more were injured. Evita herself had her own state funeral, even though she technically was not a state official, but just that of the president's wife. But the story gets even stranger and more peculiar after she died. Her husband Juan Peron had her body embalmed. Juan had this idea that he was going to create this monument dedicated to his dead wife. He was going to build this huge statue of a descamisado, the shirtless ones that supported Eva, and place Eva's embalmed body in a case at the base of this statue so she could be immortalized and people could always come and actually see her, kind of like the way Lenin's body is displayed in Russia. We've talked about Lenin's body before and I will place that video down in the description box below. While this monument was being built, they kept Evita's embalmed body in her office for 2 years. But then another military coup happened that forced Juan Peron to flee Argentina in exile. He went into exile in Spain. For about 16 years, people had no idea where Evita's embalmed body was. We now know that the body had been secretly taken out of the country of Argentina and brought all the way to Milan, Italy, with the help of the Vatican to have her buried under a fake name. While Juan was in exile in Spain, he ended up marrying his third wife. You see, Evita had been his second wife. His first wife had also passed away from cancer, so he's just batting 0 for 2 at this point. While Evita's embalmed body is hanging out in Italy, and Juan and his new wife are living up in Spain from 1955 to 1971, Peronism itself was banned from the country of Argentina. But then in 1971, Evita's embalmed body is exhumed and sent to Spain with Juan and his new wife, Isabella. It is said that Evita's body lived in their dining room, on their dining room table, and they say that Juan's new wife, Isabella, had the task of like fixing Evita's hair every morning. Like, listen, sister, if you are fixing your husband's dead wife's hair in the morning, it's safe to say you're probably not in a healthy marriage, and I would recommend getting the heck out of that marriage. Like, how creepy is that? That you have to fix your husband's dead wife's hair in the morning. In 1973, Juan is allowed to return back to Argentina. He then becomes the president again, and this time his new wife, Isabella, also becomes the vice president, a role that he wanted for Evita when she was alive. Needless to say, Evita was also brought back to the country of Argentina. Eva's body was eventually laid to rest in the La Resotelita Cemetery in Buenos Aires. She was placed in the Duarte family mausoleum. They say that her body is under a lot of trap doors, like it goes way, way down deep, which kind of is a red flag to me because now we understand about the tunnel system. Which brings me back to the Vatican. In 1995, a man named Tomas Eloy Martinez wrote a book called Santa Evita. He claims that Evita's body was used by the Vatican as well as other people for necrophilia. Now, many people scoffed his claims up as purely sensationalized fiction. But let me ask you, friends, now that we know what we know about what we know about the elites and the Vatican and all that there is, doesn't sound that fiction to me. Does it sound fiction to you? On the 50th anniversary of Evita's death on the 26th of July, 2002, her great niece, Cristina Alvarez Rodriguez, who is now an Argentine congresswoman, opened up Museo Evita. Evita's Museum, where you can go there today and see her dresses and some of her films and all the stuff that's left from her life. Now, again, we know that the entertainment industry and the government go hand in hand. We understand that today. And so I'm very, very suspicious of everything revolving around Evita Duarte Peron. She died at 33 years old. Her life was very short, and honestly, in my opinion, it was very, very tragic. They say that she was born on the wrong side of the railroad tracks. But often we know that what they tell us and what is true are two different things. I also want to point out that in the information regarding both her father and her mother, they both come from immigrants from the Basque region. This is a region in the Pyrenees between France and Spain that has the highest percentage of Rh negative blood, the pure blood of the elite. We know that a lot of our Hollywood actors today are nothing but puppets for the powers that be. And it just seems very handy that Evita got where she got, married Juan Peron, a man 24 years older than her, was able to use her position as an actress, a position of influence, to garner support of the people. Her husband then was able to allow a lot of these high-ranking Nazis into Argentina at the end of World War II, giving them new identities and new lives, giving them a place to escape their justice. And it's amazing that this woman still lives on in our hearts as her play is still performed, as people still watch her movie, the story of her life, a life that would have possibly been forgotten outside of Argentina if it wasn't for the play, the energy put into the play that sells us this story. So what do you think of the story of Evita? Do you believe the history books? Is this just a Cinderella story? Or was she a puppet for a higher purpose? A pawn, like so many actors, for the elite. As I said, most of the answers to these questions, we really won't be able to get until we have all the information available to us. But the closest we can get to these answers is connecting the dots for ourselves and our own speculations and talking to our good friend Janine and Tom, who have ways of figuring things out. And I do plan on doing an episode with them over Eva Peron and potentially trying to figure out what her true story was. Alright guys, leave me your opinions and your comments down in the comment section below. Always remember to be respectful to each other. We're all trying to walk each other home and figure all this out together. I hope that you have a wonderful, wonderful weekend. Thank you so much to Josh McKay for doing our music. If you would like to purchase the full song, there is a link down in the description box below. And thank you, as always, to Todd Roderick for helping me get this video out to you guys. I'll talk to you soon. Bye.